All right, I think everybody is coming in from the waiting room. Good evening, welcome to the Oklahoma Center for the Humanities. If you'll give me, we're gonna delay and I'm gonna fill time here for just a moment while we wait for Justin Rollins to show up, who's gonna help introduce tonight's speaker. It'll also take us just a moment to admit everyone who's in the waiting room. We have a really great streamed crowd for this evening. So it's a pleasure to welcome all of you who are joining us both live and in person. It's really nice actually to see a really good crowd in Tyrrell Hall for the first time in 2.5 years or more, something like that. So thank you all for coming out to join us this evening in person. And thank you to those of you who are joining us online. Looks like we have a good crowd and we've got our full cast available to us now. So for those who don't know, my name is Sean Latham. I'm the Pauline McFarland Walter Professor of English here at the University of Tulsa, where I serve as the director of the Oklahoma Center for the Humanities, as well as the director of the Institute for Bob Dylan Studies. And the OCH and Dylan are co-hosting this evening's event because it intersects so beautifully with the missions of both of those institutions. Before I turn over the mic to a colleague of mine from the Media Studies Department, I just want to say a few words about some upcoming events that we have going on both at the Dylan Institute and at the Oklahoma Center for the Humanities. So this Saturday, at 2 o'clock in the Zero Center downtown, which is the TU's building that sits right downtown in the Arts District, we're welcoming a multimedia artist and producer named Marianne Andre, who will be giving a talk about the cultural and natural history of the bison in America. This is in conjunction with a large exhibition that's also up in the Zero Center, available to anyone, freely open to the public throughout the day. We're open down there actually Wednesday through Saturday from noon to five. And Marianne has made a documentary that's screened on Nebraska Public Television. So she'll be screening that movie and then talking a little bit about the work and the research that went into telling the story of this wonderful story of recovery of the American bison nearly going extinct and of course being brought back now and repopulated across the Great Plains. Then on April 8th, we'll be welcoming jointly with the College of Law, Professor Stanley Fish, really one of America's most famous living literary critics, as well as always a lightning rod for controversy, a sort of famous commentator in the New York Times and other places on free speech. He'll be giving a talk called Hate Speech and the First Amendment. That will be at 5 o'clock on the 8th of April in the Zero Center, and a reception, wine and cheese reception, will follow that evening. On May 5th through 6th, we'll be hosting our annual Arts and Humanities Festival, also at the Zero Center downtown. This will be taking place as part of Mayfest, which, as you know, will bring 100,000 people through the Arts District downtown. So there'll be all kinds of things to come down and do. And this event in particular will feature student artists, filmmakers, performers, poets. There'll be all kinds of activities going on in the Zero Center that evening. So we hope you'll join us for that first Friday event. And finally, on June 3rd through the 5th, the Dylan Institute will be hosting a 3-day event called Bob Dylan and the Beats, which really looks at this sort of integral foundational American poetry movement from the mid 20th century, the beat movement, and the way it's shaped Dylan's music and career. And that will be taking place at the Zero Center as well. We're going to be welcoming scholars, musicians, journalists, artists, and many others, poets, especially some of the still living beat poets will be able to join us in Tulsa for this event. It'll be quite special. So with that, I'm now going to turn the microphone over to my colleague, Professor Justin Rollins from Media Studies. He's a former fellow actually at the Oklahoma Center for the Humanities, whose work I've gotten to know and whose friendship and I've been able to value, as well as his work as a colleague here in film and media studies at TU. And he's attended graduate school actually with tonight's speaker, so knows him far better than me. And so I'm quite happy to turn the mic over to Justin, who will introduce tonight's speaker. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Sean. And yeah, not only do we go to grad school together, we are both sons of Indiana. So you will not find a more even keeled IU basketball fan than Eric.
Go Hoosiers.
So good evening, everyone. I have the distinct honor tonight of introducing our guest speaker. Dr. Eric Harvey is Associate Professor of Multimedia Journalism at Grand Valley State University, where he also advises the outstanding student newspaper, The Lanthorn. Dr. Harvey also serves as the managing editor for the Journal of Popular Music Studies. In his own work, Eric is an incredible scholar whose book on the intersections of hip hop and reality TV, Who Got the Camera? A History of Rap and Reality, was recently published by the University of Texas Press to significant and well-deserved praise. A longtime music critic and journalist, Dr. Harvey's writing has also appeared in numerous publications, including Pitchfork, Rolling Stone, The Atlantic, The Village Voice, The New Yorker, just to name a few. Tonight, Dr. Harvey will be talking about hip hop and the 1992 LA Uprising. This talk resituates gangster rap as what rappers themselves refer to as reality rap. But this is no simple semantic coincidence Dr. Harvey's gonna talk about. As the 1980s gave way to the 1990s, both hip hop and television were redefined in a tabloid image, focusing on the violent and lurid and merging truth claims with entertainment value. Professor Harvey will be talking about how the upcoming 30th anniversary of the 1992 Los Angeles Uprising is caused to reframe how reality rappers like NWA, Ice Cube, and Ice-T, who called themselves street reporters, both contextualized the moment and took overdue credit for predicting it. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Eric Harvey.
Thanks so much, Justin and Sean. I'm just so thrilled to be here. This is such an honor, and it's been really fun today. It's been kind of a whirlwind, talking to some undergrads who I see are here, which is pretty awesome, and sort of touring some of the facilities here. There's just a remarkable presence of popular music studies at this institution, and I mean, just, I was saying earlier, I came here knowing kind of shamefully little about the city and about the program. And, I'm leaving here knowing a lot more and just so thankful that I did. And I want to extend a special thanks to Emily Every, who has facilitated me coming here and has, made everything really easy and really smooth for me to sort of, get here again, it's just a thrill, and I'm so glad that everybody has shown up, and for the folks who are online too, I really appreciate you giving me your time. So with that, we'll go ahead and get started. I think that one thing is that a couple of the slides had a video, like the first slide, it was actually should be a video, but I think it's kind of freezing up. And so I think some of you probably don't need to be reminded of what the Rodney King beating looked like, but it was, I had slowed it down, and I think it just kind of gets hung up in the PowerPoint. So just a note on that. Okay, let's see. At 12:45 a.m. on March 3rd, 1991, a Los Angeles plumber named George Holliday was awoken by the sound of helicopters over his apartment. He instinctively grabbed his new Sony Handycam, stepped onto his balcony, and started shooting. A group of LAPD officers surrounded a man, whom they were violently clubbing with their batons and shocking with their tasers. After a few minutes, the scene dispersed, and Holliday put his camera away and went back to bed. A few hours later, he used that same camera to record one of his employees running in the Los Angeles Marathon, but he remained disturbed about the brutality he'd witnessed. On Monday, Holliday took the tape to local TV station KTLA. Producers there were shocked at what they saw, and when they screened it for the LAPD, the officers expressed the same reaction. The motorist's name, Holliday learned, was Rodney King. He was Black, and the officers who brutalized him were white. The footage aired for the first time that night on KTLA's newscast, and because of a licensing agreement, was simultaneously transmitted via satellite to CNN's Atlanta Bureau. On Tuesday night, the 81-second clip that showed King's body receiving 56 baton blows and several taser shocks ran on all three national newscasts. It would air thousands more times over the coming year and a half. Without that videotape, the King beating would have most likely led to an internal affairs investigation by the LAPD, with King's injuries weighed against the fact that a Black ex-convict had led the officers on an 8-mile chase and was intoxicated and behaving strangely at the scene of the encounter. Like countless other victims of Black victims of police abuse, Rodney King would have been part of an LAPD database entry, his name forgotten by everyone except his friends and family who knew the truth. But George Holliday changed all that. Like a scientific instrument, his $1,000 Sony Handycam revealed this hidden pathogen that was always lurking just out of sight and that the news had never disclosed so clearly. There was no denying the repulsive truth of the King video, regardless of one's political position. President Bush said the video sickened him. The arch-conservative pundit George Will referred to the actions as a police riot, and even the hardline conservative LAPD chief Daryl Gates called the actions a very, very extreme use of force, extreme for any police department in America. In an April poll of registered LA County voters, 81% of respondents believe the officers were guilty. It appeared, for all intents and purposes, that after centuries of Black men being surveilled by the state, whether through slave patrols, Jim Crow, mass incarceration, that the ultimate 1990s surveillance technology, the video camera, had effectively indicted that same authority. For years before the King video, TV news directors watching the home video boom had been promoting citizen reporter initiatives in the hope of capturing the kind of spontaneous events that a professional news crew could never scramble quickly enough to get. The benefits of camcorder journalism worked both ways. Citizens could achieve the rare thrill of contributing to national news discourse, and news producers could acquire incredible footage for a small fee. For instance, KTLA paid George Holliday $500 for the Rodney King video. But for those paying attention, young Black citizen reporters have been filing crime stories from South Los Angeles for several years by that point. It's just that these reports didn't necessarily sound or look anything like the news.
Chasing up the streets to call a truce. The silly motherfucker pulls out a deuce deuce. Little did he know I had a loaded 12 gauge. One sucker dead, LA Times front page. Cause the boys in the hood are always hard. You come talking that trash, we'll pull your car. Knowing nothing in life but to be legit. Don't quote me, boy, cause I ain't said shit.
The climax of this brief interaction is not retribution for jail time, but press coverage. To Eazy-E, the rapper, and Ice Cube, who wrote the lyrics to NWA's first single, Boys in the Hood, criminal exploits were as much about earning public notoriety as street credibility, evidenced by Eazy dipping into journalistic vernacular in that last line. Eazy wants the world to know his story, but on his terms alone. When he says, "Don't quote me, boy, because I ain't said shit," he's riffing on journalism. And this journalistic riff is crucial to understanding a song that one critic called a tabloid report from the crime beat fed through a paper shredder. At once, the line suggests Eazy is talking to a local reporter and insisting this stuff happens every day. It may be newsworthy to you, but it ain't shit to me. Or he's also saying, you didn't hear this from me. Keep my name out of the story. NWA is most known for their 1989 song, Fuck the Police, a protest song that went well beyond straightforward reporting. You may be aware that this song, which was never released as a single, triggered an FBI agent to send NWA's record label a veiled threat. Perhaps even more shocking than the song itself was the fact that a government representative obliquely intimidated a music group with the specter of state-sponsored censorship. When interviewed, the agent admitted he'd never actually listened to the song and was offended merely by its title. That's too bad, because it's a great song, and it was really ahead of its time. In a cutting-edge technique for a rap record, Dr. Dre inserted dramatizations of police malfeasance between the verses, kind of like a documentary reenactment of the kind of things that young Black men in Los Angeles suffered through on a daily basis. Here's MC Ren from NWA reenacting a scene in Fuck the Police that echoes Rodney King's.
Example of scene one. Oh shit, now what the fuck you pulled me over for? Cause I feel like it. Just sit your ass on the curb and shut the fuck up. Man, fuck this shit. Alright, smart ass, I'm taking your black ass to jail. MC Ren, will you please give your testimony to the jury about this fucked up incident? Fuck the police, and Ren said it with authority. Because the niggas on the street is a majority of gang.
Despite the similarity, MC Ren's reaction to the Rodney King video 2 years later was to shrug. Quote, it ain't nothing new to me. It's just that nobody ever captured it on videotape. Eazy-E took the opportunity to acknowledge NWA's public validation. Quote, we were criticized a lot when we first released that song, but I guess now, after what happened to Rodney King, people might look differently on the situation. Eazy also, he's the entrepreneur of the group, offered Rodney King a guest spot on a charity remake of Fuck the Police, which unfortunately never materialized. A few months after the release of the Rodney King video, rapper Linda McCaskill, half of the new female duo Bitches with Problems, spoke about the video's impact. Quote, for years, rappers have been talking about police brutality and no one has taken heed of it, or justice has never been done. So now that it's been taped, it's been caught in the act and visualized. It's in black and white. We truly hope people don't forget about it just a week later. her group tried to ensure that it wouldn't be forgotten by actually licensing a clip from George Holliday's Rodney King video for the group's debut music video for a song called Wanted, showing Officer Lawrence Powell violently striking King with his baton.
Stupid police then dropped out gas, pulled out the deuce from the small of a bag. I set the POV in blue going down. Boy, was all she do, so I'm
So George Holliday owned the copyright to this video, and he was not afraid to license it. He was initially reluctant to license the footage to BWP, but the group convinced him that the video, in Holliday's words, quote, delivers the message to the public that law enforcement must respect individual rights in order to get the respect it deserves. They donated, the record label donated $1,500 to a local charity in order for the video, to use the clip from the video. The 1991 Rodney King video was more than a pivot point in the discourse of race and policing in America. It was an informational commodity and the quintessential media artifact of the first wave of reality entertainment. Though most scholars, critics, and fans date the dawn of reality TV to the turn of the millennium sensations Survivor, Big Brother, the foundation was laid a decade and a half earlier. It all started in 1986. When a certain Australian tabloid publisher named Rupert Murdoch launched Fox as the fourth broadcast TV network and immediately started populating it with pro-police series like the pseudo-documentary Cops. This is the debut episode.
At any moment's notice, because of the violence and the weapons that are in the neighborhood and because of the drug-related crimes.
Around the car. Put your hands on the car. You got anything in the car I should know about? You got any drugs or any weapons? Do you mind if I look? Okay. Just relax. Okay. Just want to take a look. I just asked you if you got any weapons underneath the seat. What's this? It's called carrying concealed firearms. You understand? Whose car is this? Who? Your car? You got some papers for it? Well, I smell marijuana. You know, I smell somebody smoking marijuana. Who, Simpson? You don't mind if we look in the trunk, do you? Okay, no problem. How's everybody doing? We're here just to look for some drugs and clean up the bad people off the street. You don't mind that, do you?
This episode, in which a white officer essentially targets and harasses relatively innocent black citizens who weren't hurting anyone, aired in March 1989, at the exact time that NWA's debut album, Straight Outta Compton, was flying off of store shelves, which makes it kind of impossible to hear these particular Ice Cube bars as anything other than...
Fucking with me, cause I'm a teenager, with a little bit of gold and a pager, searching my car, looking for the product, thinking every nigga is selling narcotics.
Though NWA and their contemporary Ice-T are most commonly called gangsta rap, they prefer a different descriptor. Let's let the rappers speak for themselves.
I don't know which writer is the one who called it gangsta rap. You know, I still call it reality rap, you know, because, you know, our stuff is much more than just talking about gangsta things. Our stuff is talking about the social climate. So to me, it means a network of information.
I mean, I feel my value is to be able to come up with something that's reality.
We're like, you know, news reporters. We're telling exactly what's going on the streets, you know? That's all it is.
You know,
street knowledge.
The situations I deal with on my album is reality. The same thing the news is bringing you, but I'm bringing it to you live and direct like the news can't give it to you because I know it. You know what I'm saying? And they just scared of it. Yeah.
The first wave of reality culture on Wax and on Fox borrowed the truth claims and stylistic tropes of news and documentary, merged them with the high-tech flash of MTV and CNN, and dove into the sort of salacious and edgy political content that was formerly reserved for supermarket tabloids, bawdy stand-up routines, and Black Panther speeches. That same year that Murdoch launched Fox, Chicago TV journalist Oprah Winfrey took her show national, following her mentor, Phil Donahue, and preceding the scandal-hungry Geraldo Rivera by a year. For the next decade and a half, daytime talk shows were a hugely popular forum for Americans formerly on the fringes of national discourse to stake their claim to a bit of national popularity, discussing the issues of the day in a way that was, let's say, a bit more energetic than the nightly news. The American discussion on race was transformed by this outlandish landscape. This 1989 Geraldo episode, in which the host sat a civil rights figure next to a white supremacist, turned the discussion on racism into something closer to professional wrestling, and just as shocking as any NWA clip.
The reason why I do that is because I get sick and tired of hearing the sob stories from kikes. I get sick and tired of seeing Uncle Tom here sucking up, trying to be a white
man. Go ahead, Roy, go ahead.
No, let me tell you. You gotta be kidding. Hey, hold it.
Studio-wide fracas left Geraldo Rivera with a broken nose and the highest ratings of his career. As the Cold War wound down, America's attention turned radically inward. We took advantage of a rapidly growing electronic communication system to create a hyper-real populist national forum to pick apart the issues emerging from a quickly diversifying and dramatically unequal population that was figuring out how to broadcast itself for the first time. This first wave of reality entertainment emerged, in other words, from the red-hot center of the culture wars, which conservatives were raising to a fever pitch. Illinois Congressman Sidney Yates connected the tumult of the time to the foolhardy crusade to snuff out Hollywood communists in the 1950s. Quote, "You've got a fight going on today that is just as emotional as the fight that took place then, except communism isn't the boogeyman. This time, it's pornography and obscenity." What came of it? By the end of the 1990s, a Vanity Fair critic dubbed the preceding 10 years the tabloid decade, when, quote, "advanced technology meant increased vulgarity in a down and dirty bonfire of epic, often comic proportions." TV executives gobbled up reality slash tabloid programming because of simple economics. The combination of sensationalism and populism drew significant ratings at a bargain. There were no writers or actors to pay, just a few hosts and some skeleton crews, if that. And the stars? They were drawn from the growing population of Americans eager to see themselves on television by any means necessary. And it went both ways. While public affairs journalism was becoming much more shocking, lurid, and entertaining, the world of entertainment was turning into a bona fide source of news itself. In 1992, media critic John Katz coined the phrase "new news" to explain how television, film, and rap albums were becoming more sharply attuned to a younger, more populist perspective on the events of the day than the official stories emanating from the corridors of power. Katz mentioned boundary-pushing 1990s sitcoms like Murphy Brown and Roseanne, but he was especially enamored of rappers and Black film directors' ability to force political discussions on race into the heart of the national conversation. Public Enemy's 1992 music video for "By the Time I Get to Arizona," for instance, catalyzed a debate over the recognition of Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday far more effectively than anything on Meet the Press. And the 1991 film "Boys in the Hood" dealt with race from a Black perspective far more fairly than the nightly news. And of course, the Rodney King video effectively verified NWA's street reporting. the new news had usurped the old news, because a growing percentage of the American population did not feel that TV or print were telling the whole truth, or at least their truth. The tabloid decade came after an interminable era during which President Ronald Reagan and a credulous broadcast media recast crime as the top domestic problem, largely by roping young black men into a starring role as the nation's lurking criminal menace. Reagan's vice president and successor, George Bush, extended the national conversation about race and crime through the hyper-real fictions of electronic media. On September 5th, 1989, he commandeered the primetime airwaves to deliver an address about, quote, the greatest domestic threat facing our nation today, crack cocaine. To drive the point home, Bush held up a bag of the drug that had been purchased in Lafayette Park across the street from the White House itself. The stagecraft was fueled by the same overheated media paranoia that the toxin spawned by the black inner city was making a beeline for the suburbs. The day after the broadcast, newspaper reporters pointed out the obvious. No one sold drugs at Lafayette Square Park because its proximity to the White House meant it was crawling with cops. Instead, DEA agents had lured a suspected dealer, a black senior at nearby Springarn High School with no prior record, to the park, where they paid him $2,400 for 3 ounces of crack. It was later revealed that the young man initially had no idea where or what the White House was. When he was informed, he replied, "Oh, you mean where Reagan lives?" Bush himself regarded the ruse as stagecraft worthy of his predecessor. Quote, "I mean, the man was caught selling drugs in front of the White House. I think it can happen in any neighborhood, and I think that's what it dramatized." As the 90s dawned, a new crop of rappers started creating their own realistic counterfictions by deploying tabloid techniques in the musical realm. The year 1986, when Rupert, Oprah, and Geraldo launched the reality TV revolution, that was also the year that Ice-T and NWA released their first singles, and it marked the debut of the digital sampler, which dramatically expanded the possibilities of hip-hop production, allowing artists to more closely mimic, for instance, the frenetic pace of modern television programming. Rappers' platinum-selling focus on sex, money, and murder was lambasted by the same mainstream news media who themselves were increasingly forcing themselves to cover disreputable tabloid trash like Joey Buttafuoco and Amy Fisher, John and Lorena Bobbitt, and later the multi-year saga of O.J. Simpson and the tawdry affair between President Bill Clinton and his intern Monica Lewinsky. In essence, the late 80s and early 90s tabloid reality moment was forged by, on one hand, Public Enemy and NWA moving hip hop from party music toward politics, and on the other hand, the news media embracing lurid entertainment along with hard news. Both sides were following television's lead. In 1988, Public Enemy frontman Chuck D told an interviewer that, quote, "rap is Black America's TV station." He was using television as a metaphor, considering its broader affordances as a medium to inspire Black Americans, especially when compared with other communications media. Like TV, hip hop offered, quote, "a whole perspective of what exists and what Black life is about," Chuck continued. Quote, "and Black life doesn't get the total spectrum of information through anything else. They don't get it through print because kids won't pick up magazines or books unless it's got pictures of rap stars." Hip hop, in other words, was perfectly suited to sample the practices, tropes, sounds, visuals, and identities of television journalists, pundits, documentarians, and primetime producers. Consider the first Fox television show to win its own time slot, America's Most Wanted, which debuted in 1988. The show deputized its viewers by showing them scandalous reenactments of violent crimes, then prompted them to call a 1-800 number and help federal agents track down the fugitives.
This is America's Most Wanted, and I'm John Walsh. Tonight, we'll ask for your help with one of the Justice Department's top priority cases, and we'll re-examine a case with a $1 million reward. But first, a story of love and passion in the hills of West Virginia.
A year later came the first solo album from Ice Cube, which he titled America's Most Wanted, slightly spelled differently, which sampled the show's host, John Walsh, and flipped the show's title into a statement on racist American policing.
Don't try to apprehend him.
Motherfucker, where the color is most wanted.
America's Most Wanted reports that Ice Cube is the leader of the lynch mob. Also in the group, they have JD, T-Bone, Chill, Yo-Yo, Del, Katie. Sounds like a black thing.
Which brings us back to April 1992. 30 years ago next month, and 13 months after Rodney King's videotape beating at the hands of the LAPD. The trial of the four officers was largely viewed as a pro forma ceremony, at the end of which the bad apples would be removed from the bunch and the world would move on. King never testified on his own behalf during the trial of the four LAPD officers. Instead, the prosecution bet that George Holliday's video could take the stand for him. But while most Americans saw the video as conclusive evidence of the officer's guilt, the most consequential viewers of King's beating were 10 whites, an Asian American, and a Latina, drawn from the conservative, mostly white Los Angeles suburb of Simi Valley, where a judge had moved the officer's trial out of a concern for fairness, even though the new venue fell squarely within Los Angeles's vast media market. During jury selection, the defense eliminated any prospective jurors who expressed negative reactions to the clip as biased, leaving the final verdict in the hands of those who either did not share the general population's horror at Holliday's footage or doubted that the video told the full story of the incident. The nation learned together that the reality of a captured event is never embedded in the pixels of a videotape, but in the specific contexts of that tape's viewing, if not manipulation. The officer's defense digitally cross-examined Holliday's footage, slowing it down and blowing it up to desensitize the jurors to its horrors and create an entirely new evidentiary artifact. The defense convinced the jurors that King was not a victim, but a subdued attacker, a belligerent black man driven to unpredictable violence by the powerful substances coursing through his body. Ice Cube himself explained it well in an LA Times interview. Quote, America looks at black men in two ways. You have the nice black man, like a Bill Cosby. This was 1992. And you have the bad black man, the person you see going to jail at night on the news. If Rodney King was seen as a good black man, then the officers would have been found guilty. But all through the trial, they kept saying that he was a monster, a wild animal. Plus, he had a past criminal record. To the jurors, he was a bad black, so anything done to him was justified. On April 29, 1992, with the nation glued to their television screens, Judge Stanley Weisberg read the jury's decision. All four officers were acquitted. Within hours, the streets filled with angry citizens, loudly airing their disgust at a plain miscarriage of justice. The on-the-ground response to the verdict initially assumed many forms, from peaceful street protests to vociferous gatherings at churches and community centers to the willful looting and destruction of city-owned buildings and private businesses. Multiple constituencies participated, from fed-up black citizens to the area's significant Latino population who were arrested in comparable numbers to black individuals, to disenfranchised whites, and the LGBT community who took to the streets in solidarity, carrying a sign that read, "Queers of all colors unite." But within hours, the city erupted into what a special committee of the California legislature later called, quote, the worst multi-ethnic urban conflict in United States history. As the uprising exploded and news crews scrambled to cover it, an odd juxtaposition transpired. It happened to be the night of the final episode of The Cosby Show, one of the most watched and critically lauded programs in American entertainment history. Again, this is 1992. This made for an awkward segue from the KNBC news desk.
Let's just to wrap it up for us, for now at least, to give you the situation as we know it. 18 confirmed deaths.
Now, you know there's a curfew on most of the city area, Los Angeles City, Torrance, Compton, Long Beach, San Fernando. Gasoline sales fill your tank, but you can't get it otherwise. Schools are closed, UCLA is closed, but the hospital and medical centers are open, but be prepared to display your ID. If you have to go anywhere tonight, be prepared to show who you are and what your business is.
Much of USC, the Santa Monica beaches are closed too, by the way.
Okay, we've got Jess here. Now, there's been some change in back and forth about what Bill Cosby intends to do because he's very concerned about this and very, of course...
Not anymore, because we're having a welcome change of pace. For 8 years, Bill Cosby has made us laugh, has made us cry, has made us think. The Cosby Show has been a breath of fresh air in a sometimes crazy and chaotic world, much like we saw today. But tonight is the final episode of The Cosby Show, their farewell. Today, Mayor Tom Bradley urged everyone in Los Angeles to remain home, to stay off the streets. He also suggested they might want to watch the Cosby Show because he believes, and we believe, we need this time, a bit of a cooling off period, giving us some breathing space. Maybe a time to remember what Thursday nights were like before all this madness began in Los Angeles. Here at KNBC, we'll use this hour to update the stories, and during this hour, if major events dictate, be assured we will return to our coverage immediately. We hope you use this hour to say goodbye and thanks to a good friend.
Pretty wild stuff. America was watching a profound transformation in black.
I got him!
America was watching a profound transformation in black popular culture. While the streets of Los Angeles were being taken over by thousands of young black men who had been locked out of the American dream, Cliff Huxtable, the avatar of lighthearted 1980s African-American upward mobility, was preparing for his son Theo to graduate from NYU, looking for him with binoculars from the crowd, and then wistfully recalling a moment from the show's first season when he taught his son the value of financial literacy with Monopoly money. Though it was catalyzed by the King verdict, the LA uprising from April 29th through May 4th, 1992, was overdetermined by numerous other factors: over-policing, mass incarceration, economic devastation, that were impossible to understand and portray from a single journalistic perspective. The writer and critic Norman Klein observed that, quote, "In an event as massive as this, to be present at one street corner does not make you a reliable source, nor does it give you enough background to discuss long-term causes, the subtleties of a particular street, its normalcies, its survival. Panic was the story that made this a ratings bonanza." Thanks to nonstop television coverage, the uprising became a dramatic high-tech television blockbuster. The racialized crime panic of local television news coverage became a week-long national television spectacle, with endless helicopter shots of dramatic building fires and interchangeable ethnic locals referred to as hooligans, thugs, smashing windows and looting stores. When it was over, it was reduced to statistics that disguised more than they revealed. More than 60 deaths, over 2,000 injuries, 12,000 arrests, and property damage upwards of $1 billion. But attempts to define what the event meant lasted much longer. For more than a year, everyone from national politicians to reality rappers and sitcom and TV drama producers would attempt to give this seismic event some semblance of narrative. Part of that narrative relied on an uprising from a quarter century earlier in Watts, spurred by decades of racist police violence and ignited by some LA highway patrolmen stopping and harassing a black motorist. Black residents rebelled for several days in October 1965, burning large portions of their white-owned neighborhood to the ground. The rebellion helped to radicalize a generation of young black men: Bobby Seale and Huey Newton, who would go on to found the Black Panthers; the writer Robert Beck, who, as the literary pimp Iceberg Slim, would go on to inspire a generation of rappers, including Ice-T; and the stand-up comedian Richard Pryor, whose routines became much more political in the late 1960s. Also established in the aftermath, was the Watts Writers Workshop. Out of this workshop came a group called the Watts Prophets, a trio of poet musicians who brought the language of the Black streets into dialogue with the long tradition of Black oral poetics. While the growing Black Power movement had started ushering the word Negro into the historical dustbin, the Prophets' work pushed the descriptors even further, planting the seeds for hip hop in the process. I do not know what this stuff is at the bottom here. It's supposed to be the name of the song, which you'll learn here in a second, and which I am not going to be saying out loud.
Look at them flames lighting up the sky. Ain't never seen fire shooting up so high.
I ain't never seen fire shooting up so high. Are you listening, people, to what I'm saying? Because it sure looks to me like them niggas ain't playing. Ever since they passed them civil rights, those fires have been lighting up the nights. And they say they ain't gonna stop till we all have equal rights. Looks to me like them niggas ain't playing.
Them niggas ain't playing.
Them niggas ain't playing.
Nearly 26 years after Watts, on the evening of April 29th, a swarm of news helicopters redeployed from their usual work of filing traffic reports and tracking high-speed chases to hover above the intersection of Florence and Normandy in south central Los Angeles. Hundreds of black locals had taken to the streets, and a few broke into a liquor store and made off with armloads of booze. Locals who saw their neighbors clearing out stores live on television with not a cop in sight left their sofas to join in. Meanwhile, a white truck driver named Reginald Denny was heading through the intersection on his way to drop off a delivery, unaware of the acquittal. As the helicopter cameras rolled, Denny was dragged from his cab and beaten unconscious by several black men live on television. One of them knocked Denny's body limp by throwing a slab of concrete at his head, and then looked upward to the helicopter and flashed the sign of the 8 Trey gangster Crips, like a hunter posing next to his bagged prey. Bloodied and near death, Denny lay unattended in the intersection for several minutes while other men spit on him, emptied his pockets, and threw a bottle at his body. After the cameras had moved on, he was rescued by a group of black locals who sped to the scene after watching his beating on television. To reporters piecing together a narrative as they went, the Denny beating became a stomach-churning stand-in for the racialized retribution transpiring in South Central, and a bit of journalistic both sides balance for the King video. 2 weeks later, Chief Daryl Gates, who's always looking for his own time in the spotlight, himself placed the handcuffs on one of Denny's assailants with news cameras in tow. The following November, Denny forgave another one of his assaulters on an episode of The Phil Donahue Show. For most of the uprising, television journalists and citizen videographers seemed to dwarf the presence of law enforcement. The week-long spectacle of arson and looting cast local TV news reporters as something like war correspondents, filing reports in front of broken store windows while B-roll footage of burning buildings suggested that the City of Angels had descended into the lawless anarchy of a post-apocalyptic action blockbuster. But as the smoke cleared, a sharper street-level picture of the rebellion started to emerge, thanks in part to hip-hop media. Founded in 1988 as a tip sheet for a quickly growing hip-hop industry, The Source had grown by leaps and bounds along with hip-hop itself. The magazine wasn't just covering new releases from NWA and Public Enemy and Ice Cube anymore, but by 1992 was calling itself the magazine of hip-hop music, culture, and politics. The August 1992 issue, which hit stands in the aftermath of the uprising, featured Oakland pimp rapper Too Short on the cover, but devoted significant space to coverage of the uprising. Quote, Chuck D's 1988 warning about the media still holds true today, read the editorial. Most anything reported about the black community is coming from an outsider's perspective, which surely means there will be misunderstandings, and that leads to misrepresentation. Source editor James Bernard flew to South Central immediately after the verdict and filed a lengthy report on what he called the hip-hop generation's last collective gasp. Oh, I'm sorry, first collective gasp. After LA Mayor Tom Bradley lifted the curfew, officially ending the uprising, Bernard took a ride through the city with some local filmmakers and gang members. Quote, I was surprised about how carefully chosen the rioters' targets were, he explained. One of his interlocutors called the looting and arson, quote, surgical strikes. Another resident affirmed, quote, oh, we knew what businesses we wanted out of the neighborhood. When Bernard noted that the, quote, corporate monster McDonald's was still standing, he was informed that they hire a lot of blacks from the community. A Comfort Inn was left untouched, Bernard was told, because the brand name had made an appearance in an Ice Cube track. Bernard's interviewee said with a laugh, where else are the fellas going to take their girls? Bernard's tour of post-rebellion LA led him to the conclusion, absorbed by hip-hop heads across the country, that, quote, the riots were really a very disciplined and spontaneous cry for economic empowerment. Daytime talk shows provided another emotional forum to come to terms with the reality of the rebellion. Phil Donahue convened a combative panel that included LA DA Ira Reiner, the Reverend Al Sharpton, and Officer Theodore Brasino, one of the four LAPD officers charged in King's beating. The episode's most dramatic moment came when a police spokesman insisted that it was, quote, time for healing, prompting Sharpton to sharply retort that it was actually time for justice. The moment resulted in the episode's long There may be some young people in the audience who aren't familiar with Donahue or Oprah, that their use of audience participation to simulate a forum of average opinion in a manner of speaking. The first wave of reality television covered the aftermath of the uprising.
Yes, briefly, sir, you wanted to say.
Yes, I don't believe that the rioting...
Whoops. Let's go wait a minute.
And the looting of the property and the killing of innocent people enhances the cause to fight against racism.
Yes.
If we as a society would repent, God will heal our land.
Yes.
The jury is guilty.
Yes.
Yes. I wonder about whether there was any jury tampering.
Yes.
What if Rodney King had been a female and those police officers had been raping her on videotape? Then what?
Yes, sir, you wanted to say.
We've got to get respect back for authority in all walks of life.
Here's Oprah.
What does the looting, the televisions, the shoes, the whatever you're looting for, have to do with Rodney King? So why did you do it?
Well, you have to understand what happened to why we did it.
Okay, yeah,
the reason we did it was because we needed self-satisfaction. Uh-huh. We had no satisfaction in what happened to Rodney King. 425 years of being unsatisfied, what am I to do?
Mm-hmm.
What am I to do? I'm looking at the news and they telling me my life is not worth a nickel. They're telling me that they could beat me. They can do whatever they want to me whenever they feel like it.
Uh-huh.
And I'm supposed to accept this and say, well, we'll just go vote and make it better. It hasn't been better. We've been voting for years, and it's not changing.
When after the stuff that you got, some of the things that you got, did you feel better after that?
Definitely. I felt better.
You felt 100%
better? 100%
better.
I can't even lie. I felt better.
Nope. Right. Yes. Yes, ma'am. You wanted to say what?
I just wanted to say I'm for the verdict. I'm not condoning what the officers did. I think they got a little bit of out of hand, of course. But listen. Okay, I'm telling you, we did not.
Okay, I'm going to see if I can resync this because this is worth it.
Right. Yes. Yes, ma'am. You wanted to say what?
I just wanted to say I'm for the verdict. I'm not condoning what the officers did. I think they got a little bit of out of hand, of course. But listen. Okay, I'm telling you, we did not see the first 60 seconds of that video. We did not. No. Did you go? No, listen. The media. Listen to me.
Everybody?
The media is our number one influencing agent. And that's all we saw was what the media decided to put up on that screen.
Okay, we get the point. The reality rappers, though, who had been chronicling the festering unease between Black citizens and police for years, were finally being regarded as journalists and pundits, at least for the moment. Quote, it should now be obvious to all that rappers are reporting real events and not just striking tough guy poses, wrote Rolling Stone. While the uprising was still happening, Ice-T called a reporter from his car phone while driving through South Central. Quote, I'm not saying I told you so, but rappers have been reporting from the front for years. Public Enemy, Ice Cube, we were all saying that you have a potentially explosive situation. My answer to what happened is, quote, refer to album 3, track 5. Ice Cube questioned the media's framing. First of all, quote, I don't even call it a riot. I call it an uprising. Unfortunately, in this country, quiet protest really doesn't work. You can hold your signs, you can march, you can do all these things, but conditions aren't going to change. Tupac Shakur, a rising Oakland rapper whose debut album, Tupacalypse Now, had been released the previous November, said, quote, we've been reporting this. When you hear Ice Cube or Public Enemy, you know you're not alone. It's like being in Vietnam and seeing another soldier on the battlefield. Yet while reality rappers were receiving overdue credit for their street reporting, state authority figures were seeking a hip-hop scapegoat to deflect attention away from the real problems in the aftermath of the uprising. That scapegoat would be Ice-T. In the May 29th issue of The Shield, released exactly a month after the LAPD officer's not guilty verdict, The Dallas Police Association's monthly newsletter wrote an article titled, quote, "New Rap Song Encourages Killing Police Officers," written on a tip from a fellow officer whose daughter had apparently brought home the self-titled album from Ice-T's punk metal side project, Body Count, which contained a track called Cop Killer. The article read in part, quote, "I urge you to boycott any and all Time Warner products and movies until such time as they have recalled this tape." Though the Body Count album had been released to little notice that previous March, and Body Count had performed the song multiple times at the previous year's Lollapalooza Festival, it became suddenly the most controversial song in America when Texas's largest police union held a press conference on June 10th to decry it and promote it. On the track, Ice-T plays a character who explodes after a lifetime of harassment, spending about half the song shouting "fuck the police" and naming Daryl Gates, the LAPD, and Rodney King in his lyrics. Going after the liberal entertainment industry was a perfect election year wedge issue, especially for Republican candidate George H.W. Bush, who used his vice president, Dan Quayle, to assail rap music for the deep problems between Black Americans and the police. In a press statement, Quayle crowed that, quote, "Time Warner is making money, a lot of it, off a record that is suggesting it's okay to kill cops." Never one to back down from a challenge, Ice-T, who saw the album sales skyrocket after the calls for a boycott, responded by comparing his lyrics to America's foundational conflict. Quote, "Have they forgotten that Paul Revere became a revolutionary war hero for warning everybody, the police are coming, the police are coming?" But the skirmish quickly exploded into the latest front page controversy, pitting artistic freedom against claims of incitement. Along with rap fans, the artistic community, the ACLU, and the National Black Police Association, Ice-T's free speech cause was supported by Gerald Levin, the president and CEO of Time Warner, who published an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal titled, "Why We Won't Withdraw Cop Killer." Outside of Southern California, the battle over Cop Killer made Rodney King and the LA Rebellion feel like distant memories, which, of course, was the point. A week after Body Count arrived in stores, the Public Enemy-affiliated rapper Sister Soulja released her debut album, 360 Degrees of Power, also to relatively little notice. In May, during a press cycle interview with the Washington Post, Soulja was asked to comment on the LA uprising. As in her powerful public oratory, Soulja unapologetically decried racial double standards. "If Black people kill Black people every day, why not have a week and kill white people? You understand what I'm saying? In other words, white people, this government, and that mayor were well aware of the fact that Black people were dying every day in Los Angeles under gang violence. So if you're a gang member and you would normally be killing somebody, why not kill a white person? Do you think that somebody thinks that white people are better or above dying when they would kill their own kind?" Soulja had expressed a sentiment little different from Ice Cube's America's Most Wanted. The white American power structure was fine to ignore Black criminality as long as it could be contained within Black communities. But in the heat of a presidential election, the quote provided the perfect platform for Democratic candidate Bill Clinton to speak to Black America out of both sides of his mouth. Clinton was a centrist, seeking to signal to moderate white voters that he could stand up to powerful Black interest groups. With Sister Soulja, he found his opportunity. Clinton gave a campaign speech to Jesse Jackson's Rainbow Coalition on June 13th, one day after Soulja herself had talked to the group. To a quietly astonished crowd, Clinton isolated a part of her Washington Post interview for rhetorical effect, quote, "If Black people kill Black people every day, why not have a week and kill white people?" If you took the words white and Black and reversed them, Clinton said, you might think David Duke was giving that speech. The next day, Sister Soulja held her own press conference, unrepentantly claiming that she was being, quote, used as a vehicle, like Willie Horton and various other Black victims of racism. A complete unknown on the national scene only a month earlier, Sister Soulja now was on the cover of Newsweek in June and was a subject, along with Ice-T, of a feature article titled Rap and Race. The article zeroed in on the core rationale for the explosion of media interest in hip-hop. Black musicians had taken over American popular culture without even pretending to cater to white tastes or white politics. As the summer wound on and hip-hop became the stand-in for substantive discussions on race and policing, conservative attacks on cop killer increased. Soulja's music and message had no risk of crossing over to white audiences. Body Count, who performed a punk metal hybrid, quote, got inside suburbia a little deeper than a normal rap record would, in Ice-T's explanation. That summer, he took his anti-cop trolling to a new level, appearing on the cover of Rolling Stone in a police uniform. But he would soon learn that even though Time Warner's CEO characterized his music as, quote, the CNN of the streets, conservative protesters were picketing the corporation's annual shareholder meeting. On July 28th, Ice-T held a press conference at which he announced that he approved pulling Cop Killer from future editions of the Body Count album. It was a strange and unprecedented announcement in light of Ice-T's status as one of the country's most prominent First Amendment advocates. Even odder was Ice-T himself taking personal responsibility for the action out of concern, he said, for the safety of Warner Brothers and Sire staffers who he claimed had received death threats from police officers. Rap fans were shocked that the rapper who had spent his entire career going directly after the mass media powers that be would fold so quickly. The sources, Reginald T. Dennis, condensed the reaction into an apocalyptic prediction. Quote, mark July 28, 1992, as the beginning of the end of rap music. If Ice-T's next album was going to be as uncensored as the rapper had promised, Dennis worried, quote, the only place we will be able to hear it is in his living room. The censors had won. They successfully eradicated the recording from commercial circulation and shifted the national discourse from post-rebellion protest to a referendum on hip-hop incitement. The source's James Bernard had it right in a September 1992 editorial. Quote, as long as rappers get cast as the enemy, those who twist the knobs of this twisted society get off the hook. We end up talking about cop killer rather than killer cops. We end up debating whether Sister Soulja is a racist rather than holding those in the White House and corporate America responsible for the destruction of our communities. Sister Soulja wasn't done yet, though. The sixth season premiere of the Cosby Show spinoff, A Different World, devoted a two-part episode to the rebellion based around the main characters, Dwayne Wayne and Whitley Gilbert, recounting to their Hillman College friends their Los Angeles honeymoon during the uprising. Whitley finds herself in an electronics store with a wall of televisions in the background when the verdict is announced. In a state of shock, she meets a woman named Ianta. This is Sister Soulja in a cameo appearance.
What happened?
They just acquitted the officers that beat up Rodney King.
How could they acquit him? I mean, it was on tape. Hard evidence.
Everyone saw it.
Girl, please. They can beat us, kill us, do whatever they want. And get off just like they always have. We serve the Constitution to protect us. When that piece of paper was written, African people in this country were slaves. All of us. We sisters were considered nothing but bag warmers.
Well, we have our rights now. I mean, they're not going to deny me. I'm an African American.
Hey, Miss Lambchop, stop worrying about integrating and being accepted. And start thinking about building for yourself, for our people, so that we can provide a future for our children.
Three months after Bill Clinton turned her into a national pariah, Soulja took her nationalist oratory to the stage of the most popular Black sitcom in America. The live studio audience, as you heard, broke into applause. A few months later, it was Ice Cube's turn to hold forth on the rebellion on his November 1992 album, The Predator. This is Ice Cube's dramatization of the uprising, and it opens with a smash cut from a sample of Nashville Mayor Ben West responding to violence at a 1961 sit-in. This was sampled from a VHS tape of the PBS civil rights documentary, Eyes on the Prize, to Tom Brokaw announcing the King verdict.
Peace, quiet, and good order will be maintained in our city to the best of our ability. Riots, melees, and disturbances of the peace are against the interest of all our people and therefore cannot be permitted.
The jury found that they were all not guilty, not guilty, not guilty,
We've been
not guilty,
all
not
along
guilty.
Crenshaw Boulevard, that there's a series of fires. A lot of looting is going on. A disaster area, obviously.
The jury found that they were all not guilty, not guilty.
Make it rough.
In the rest of the track, Cube reels off a litany of grievances and imagined scenarios, from fantasies about murdering the officers to the racial economy of looting and arson. At one point, he rhymes, "Don't fuck with the black-owned stores, but hit the Foot Lockers." He shouts out L.A. County District Attorney Ira Reiner, blames him for letting Rodney King's assailants get off free, and he rhymes Simi Valley with KKK rally. It ends with Cube pivoting back to Los Angeles's racial reckoning by sampling a TV interview he did. Where's the mouse? There it is. Whoops. Oh, wait.
I do want the white community to understand our community more and see what's going on and see what the things they've done to us in the past are still affecting us now, mentally, you know. And the reason I did is because, I mean, everything I said about, you know, everything I said on records before the riot, you know, anything you wanted to know about the riot was in the records before the riot. So all you had to do was go to the Ice Cube library and pick a record, and it would have told you, you know.
So in other words, it's almost like a warning or a prophecy.
I've given so many warnings on what's going to happen if we don't get these things straight in our lives.
The Predator positioned Ice Cube as a black vigilante speaking in the media's own language. He used the album's liner notes to focus his message, sarcastically thinking, quote, "America's cops for their systematic and brutal killings of brothers all over the country," parentheses, "most of their stories never made it to the camera," end quote. Accordingly, the Predator's most intelligent and persuasive moment is the track "Who Got the Camera," where Cube solidifies the role of citizen videography in the existential power struggle between police and black men. In a post-Rodney King landscape, Cube's first instinct upon being pulled over and harassed is no longer to reach for a gun.
The one that called me a spook, his name is Officer David Duke. If the crowd wasn't around, he would have shot me. Tried to play me out like my name was Rodney. Fucking police getting badder, cause if I had a camera, the shit wouldn't matter.
The images recorded by George Holliday's handycam might not have made a difference in the Simi Valley courtroom, but Cube held out hope that pointing and shooting with a Sony was still a viable alternative to the same action with a Smith & Wesson. Cube's imagined retaliatory tactics rarely correspond with the nonviolent ideologies of Martin Luther King's civil rights movement. But on camera, he argued that the novel world of consumer videography might offer a productive update of King's marches and sit-ins, crafted as they were for the then new medium of broadcast television. It might not have convicted Rodney King's assaulters, but the video camera still might usefully function as a weapon of representation. The South, by the way, I named my book after this song. It's available at various places where you can buy it. It makes a great gift. The South Central filmmaker Matty McDaniel agreed. A key cog in the LA hip hop scene, McDaniel, who you see holding the microphone here, used his VHS camcorder to become what Big Daddy Kane later called, quote, "the West Coast Walter Cronkite." After the King verdict was announced, McDaniel headed to the streets of South Central and chronicled the rebellion, which he edited into a film titled Birth of a Nation, 4/29/92. McDaniel's title, a nod toward D.W. Griffith's epic and famously racist 1915 Civil War drama, neatly encapsulates the merger of black nationalist rhetoric and the hardcore violence of reality rap. The opening text establishes the film's ideological aim. Later in the film, he edits in a Bryant Gumbel interview from the Today Show with Sheena Lester, a writer from the black newspaper, the Los Angeles Sentinel.
Lester writes about young people for the black-owned Los Angeles Sentinel. This morning, she's on the corner of Western and Romaine in Hollywood. Miss Lester, good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. Those called to the White House, how are they viewed by those in the streets of L.A.?
Well, I think that they were viewed really just as a, you know, just more pap and rhetoric from the White House. I think that young people today, they really feel completely out of touch with those people that President Bush considers among the black leadership in this country.
Well, who should President Bush have been talking to if not those people?
Well, on behalf of young people, he probably should have been turning a little bit more towards the rap community, people like Ice Cube and Karis One, Sister Soulja, James Bernard, people like that. We're more in touch with young people in their reality.
The sync was a little bit off there, but what she was saying was that President Bush, instead of talking to the people he was talking to, should consider reality rappers among the nation's experts on the current moment in Los Angeles. Dr. Dre, on the other hand, was not one of Lester's black leaders. He was much more an entrepreneur by this point than a political figure. Having split from NWA, Dre was recording his first solo album during the rebellion. McDaniel had known Dre for years and stopped by the studio to play him some raw footage from the agitated Wednesday evening gathering at the South Central AME church right after the verdict had been announced. Out of the vociferous crowd, one man emerged. So what I've done here is I've edited together the original clip with what Dr. Dre, the music Dr. Dre put under it.
Black and green. Yeah, buy.
Hey, all of y'all. All of y'all that buy shit.
I'm gonna say this and I'm gonna end mine. If you ain't down for the Africans here in the United States, period, point blank, if you ain't down for the ones that suffer in South Africa from apartheid and shit, David, you need to step your fuck ass to the right and let us brothers and us Africans come down here and start putting some foot in it.
Dre incorporated this clip into the lone LA Uprising theme track from his blockbuster album, The Chronic, which came out a month after The Predator. The album commemorated the rise of a new archetype for black popular culture, one that had little revolutionary politics, but a surfeit of stylized black anger. This track positions the LA Uprising not as the birth of a new nation as much as the triumph of reality rap as a form of radical black consumerism.
Yeah, this is DJ.
Among the Chronic's numerous musical legacies is its establishment of a new sonic lane for hip hop, rooted in a sense of calmness and temporary unity that arose in the wake of the uprising. It was captured most prominently by the November 1992 single, Nothing But a G Thing. Based on an interpolation of Leon Haywood's sinuous 1975 bedroom R&B jam, I Want to Do Something Freaky to You, and a supple, keening sine wave melody that Dre coaxed out of his Mini Moog synthesizer, G-Thang rebranded reality rap as a chilled-out post-rebellion soundtrack. The video was based around a single day in black suburban Los Angeles, where the police were no longer a rival gang, but just a distant danger. In a symbolic rebuke to the post-Rodney King world of hyper-cautious black motorists, Dre and his protege Snoop Doggy Dogg, who comes in here in a second, peacefully cruise through the city in exorbitantly detailed lowriders. The video opens with Dre pulling up to Snoop's home to pick him up for a neighborhood picnic, walking through the front yard and winding through the home of an extended family starting its day. After a day of revelry, the crew caravan to a party at another suburban residence, fueled by 40-ounce bottles of malt liquor and copious amounts of the high-potency weed that gives The Chronic its title. As the sun rises, Dre drops Snoop back at home. Maybe I can get this part. Dre drops Snoop back at home, where he drunkenly stumbles toward the front door. Reality rap had gone fully. Reality rap had gone fully suburban and had been rebranded as G-Funk. The video for Let Me Ride, released in September 1993, was the next episode promised by Dre and Snoop in the G-Thang chorus. The Let Me Ride video is a documentary of black car culture in LA, prominently featuring local landmarks like the Crenshaw Car Wash and slowly panning across the Crenshaw and Slauson street signs, as if to establish that intersection as the new symbolic center of black Los Angeles, replacing Florence and Normandy, where Reginald Denny was beaten. Violence bleeds into Dre's periphery, but he drives right past it. Quote, "This is the kind of idyllic Arcadian vision of inner city Los Angeles that everybody wants to exist," wrote Jonathan Gold of the video in Rolling Stone. In early 1993, Ice Cube released his own smooth R&B vision themed to the absence of death and violence in Black Los Angeles. It Was a Good Day is built from the Isley Brothers' lush 1977 Quiet Storm staple, Footsteps in the Dark, and its music video opens on nearly the same note as G-Thing, with a tracking shot following a young girl into a ranch-style suburban home through the interior hallways to Cube, who, like Snoop, gets up from bed to start his day. I don't know, but today seems kind of odd, Cube observes, as he moves through a peaceful dream sequence vision of South Central Los Angeles. At one point, he takes note that the omnipresent sound of the helicopter looking for the murder had been replaced in the skies over South Central by a congratulatory message on the side of a Goodyear blimp. The Predator went multi-platinum and debuted at number one on the Billboard chart, higher than The Chronic, which peaked at number three. But it was Dre's comparatively apolitical album that would become the cultural icon, an ascent symbolized by a few bars from Let Me Ride.
This, no medallions, dreadlocks, or black fists. It's just that gangsta glare with gangsta raps. That gangsta shit makes the gangsta snaps.
The Chronic heralded the rise of what rap writer Jeff Chang called a guiltless, gentrified gangsta, a world of lowriders, copious numbers of voiceless bitches, and thick plumes of weed smoke. Dre's primary on-record enemies were not cops or censors, but his industry competition, including his ex-NWA groupmate, Eazy-E. With verbal battles over personal authenticity slowly overtaking reality rappers' diatribes against racist authority, The Chronic shared much with MTV's summer 1992 entry into the reality TV landscape, The Real World. In just a few years, reality rap had come a long way from the funky anti-cop agitprop of Fuck the Police. Along with Ice-T, the members of NWA used hip-hop as a platform to intervene not just in popular culture, but the far broader discussions about Black lives in a nation that had long shunted their voices to the sidelines. What transpired was an entertaining and shocking power struggle over the right to express themselves on the issues of the day. That moment was never going to last forever, and it soon morphed into something else. Yet tabloid culture and reality entertainment marked a profound transformation in American public life and how we make sense of the political that continues to this day. For the late cultural studies theorist Stuart Hall, such transformations are the entire point of popular culture, which itself is a site where relations of control and subordination are constantly shifting and cultural forms gain and lose support from dominant institutions. Writing about what he termed the dialectic of cultural struggle, Hall asserted that the back and forth, quote, goes on continuously in the complex lines of resistance and acceptance, refusal and capitulation, which made the field of culture a sort of constant battlefield where no once for all victories are obtained, but where there are always strategic positions to be won and lost. By 2015, reality rap had ascended what Hall called the escalator of cultural prestige, with NWA's story made into a blockbuster Hollywood biopic and the group earning entry into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. But at the same time, the field of popular culture has been inundated with a mediated reality far beyond what happened in 1991 and 1992. Through the videotaped police killings of Eric Garner, Philando Castile, George Floyd, and numerous other young Black men. 3 decades after Ice Cube asked, who got the camera? The answer is everyone, everywhere, at all times. The battle continues. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much for that, Eric. It was terrific. So we've got room for questions. I'm gonna monitor some from the chat. So if you're joining us virtually, I'll be monitoring the chat and feeding some questions to Eric from the chat. Those of you who are here, please go ahead and ask questions as well. I will just remind you, because we're streaming this event, ask questions as concisely as you can. If you're in person, Eric will repeat them so that the folks at home can hear what's been asked. So please, questions, comments, ideas?
I covered it all.
And of course, if you're at home, please add questions to the chat as well. Ben.
Yes, Eric, Dr. Harvey, that was really rich tapestry. Thank you so much. It just gave you like
audio digitally textured, the story was itself a performance. The argument I found really moving. I was just, you know, reflecting on the really moving arguments about the like surprising relationship between reality map and reality TV and how they merge over time in ways that I could never have consumed. And I'm just wondering, like, you in your argument, does the work of surveillance play? I mean, I think you touched on it a bit, but I was wondering if you could just say a couple more words about how surveillance, it seems, would help us understand what the work of being watched is. Mark Andreevich talks about reality TV. Or also how, like, the surveillance also helps us understand the kind of black subject in this emerging trend. This somebody who's a victim who's protesting, using a media power for its own self-empowerment, but then becoming kind of whitewashed or mainstream. So I don't know if surveillance is a helpful or if it is interesting.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And for the folks at home, the question was about, you know, how can we think about this issue through the lens, so to speak, of surveillance? And I think it's a really useful way, you know, in the conclusion, I do cite Andreevich, and I talk about the idea of reality television as we know it now. You think of shows like Big Brother, which is essentially, you know, shot with surveillance cameras. It's part of its aesthetic. As you know, reality television is the work of being watched, as you said, and it's subjecting yourself to cameras to have your sort of everyday activities dramatized, captured, mediatized for entertainment purposes. And obviously in 2022, this is sort of, you know, you look at Instagram, influencers, YouTubers, you know, TikTok, and you know, the I think we've become sort of used to this as part of sort of the work of everyday life, of just sort of living. It's like, it, you know, picture it didn't happen, right? You know, one thing I think it's interesting is thinking about how a lot of people watch live concerts through their phones. I think we can actually kind of look at that as a symptom of a larger idea that for a lot of people, I think maybe young people, but I think also, you know, people of all ages, things don't seem real until they're mediated. I think this is one of the ironies that some other theorists, Baudrillard and others have kind of touched upon, is that things don't, you know, unless there is some sort of footage of an event, it doesn't feel like it's actually transpired. It doesn't feel like it's real. It doesn't feel like it has proof. It doesn't feel like it has any kind of textuality to it. I also think that, you know, the 1980s rise of camcorders, and, you know, which some of us of a certain age lived through and remember kind of, you know, I remember in the late 80s and early 90s, you know, sort of living through the moment when birthday parties and Little League games started to become something that we recorded, and it started to feel almost like a necessity, right? Like, if we don't record this, we're going to forget it, you know? And we started kind of seeding bits of our memory to these, you know, sort of reels of magnetic tape that sort of stacked up, and we never watched, you know, necessarily until maybe kind of years down the line. And we're like, oh, wow, we're old now. And once we were young. I think, you know, I remember some people at the time, when I was 13 at the time, so I don't remember it at the time, but at the time people were talking about sort of a democratization of surveillance culture, right? So, you know, these aren't just the cameras, the CCTV cameras that are kind of installed in public spaces, but everybody now has access to the means of surveillance. And so it could be something where you could say, well, if surveillance becomes so surveillance permeates society so much, is it even surveillance anymore? Are we just kind of doing our own work of, you know, surveilling ourselves? And, you know, one of the kind of depressing things, you know, about writing this book, a lot of it was depressing, was, you know, thinking about, you know, the title, Who Got the Camera, right? And the idea that, okay, with enough technology, bad things will go away. If we can just, right, sunlight is the best disinfectant, this kind of idea. And it's not, right? It's not happened, right? You know, instead of videotapes kind of shaming, you know, racist police officers into not killing Black men, what we have is sort of a standing archive of Black death on the internet and on social media. And so, you know, I'm not necessarily one of the people who says that, oh, we're just being desensitized to it. I don't think we are. I don't think that, you know, viewing these killings, these murders over and over again is going to make us, you know, kind of come to terms with them as sort of a necessary reality. I would certainly hope not, but they're not solving anything necessarily, not at a large scale. A lot of these officers, you know, because they're running up into, you know, technological power runs up into state power, runs up into this larger kind of performative ritualistic power of, okay, well, we gave them their trial, we gave them their fair shake, that, you know, the tape was, you know, admitted into evidence, and you know what, we're going to give them another chance. So, you know, do better and move on. And so, I'm ambivalent on the idea of surveillance, and not just because I think it's been co-opted and sort of, you know, swept up into consumer culture and commodity culture, whether it's on Instagram or YouTube, where, you know, we're just kind of recording every kind of aspect of our daily lives or sharing them on social media. I think this is an Andreevic point, you know, but he was writing about surveillance culture in 2000 as reality television in like 2004, you know, this is before the Kardashians. This is, you know, and you know, then you can think about, well, to what extent on social media are we kind of self-surveilling? Are we just kind of, you know, conditioning ourselves to think, you know, just by revealing these little chunks of our lives, you know, kind of out into the public, as sort of, you know, little bite-sized bits of entertainment, are we sort of, you know, sort of participating and conditioning ourselves to accept this kind of stuff as normal? And so, yeah, again, I think ambivalence is my main reaction to that, unfortunately.
Your panda. Okay. Oh, it's my wife.
That's a good question.
Yes. So when did rap really begin to take off in popularity with white suburban kids, and how did this influence the course of rap, especially ending the way your talk ended with the sort of actually return, you know, sort of idyllic white sort of suburban neighborhood is all of a sudden the home of rap, but it's cool because you just smoke weed and listen to great music.
Yeah. I mean, you know, part of my answer to this question is my own autobiography, which is, you know, I was a teenager when, I was talking to some folks about this earlier, when I was watching the video for Gin and Juice by Snoop Doggy Dogg, and it came out in 1993, and I'm watching this and I'm seeing East Coast rap was took place in a very kind of condensed, very, you know, everybody's living on top of each other. West Coast rap, you know, South Los Angeles rap was spread out, right? I'm not saying the suburbs of South Los Angeles or anything like the suburbs of Indianapolis, where I grew up, of course. But at the same time, when I'm seeing Snoop Dogg riding on the handlebars of his friend's bicycle down the street, I'm like, hell yeah, you know? And when I'm seeing them sitting on their front porch in front of a neatly manicured lawn with a fence around it, I'm like, yes, I recognize that. Like, this is the kind of space that I can understand. And I think it's interesting to think about the character. You know, we know who Snoop Dogg is today. Back then it was Snoop Doggy Dogg, more syllables. But he was at once positioning himself as a very dangerous criminal, right? I mean, he had an actual murder case hanging over his head for the first 3 or 4 years of his career. He was, you know, facing life in prison for accessory to murder, while he released the highest selling debut album in history that would be eclipsed later by Eminem. But on the other hand, if you go back, and I encourage you, go back and watch the Gin and Juice video, it is adorable. It is Snoop Doggy Dogg. If you've ever seen the movie House Party, it's Snoop Dogg's parents leaving and Snoop throws a party, right? And he starts off and he looks at the camera and does the Home Alone pose. And he looks and it says Homeboy Alone, right? And then he just has fun, right? He breaks up a fight in his neighborhood, right? He has his hair braided on his front porch by one of his friends. He rides on the handlebars of his friend's bicycle. This is really like Ice Cube started this kind of day in the hood idea with a video called Steady Mobbin' that came out in 1991. Right when Ice Cube was blowing up, he was in Boys in the Hood, and this is obviously right after the King video. But Snoop really took, and Ice Cube would obviously take, if you've ever seen the movie Friday, Ice Cube in 1995, you know, sort of pioneered this idea that you can have sort of day in the life, kind of innocent suburban comedies about South Los Angeles, about South Central, about Compton, just in the way that you can have those, you know, taking place in any other kind of white suburb. And the thing I just, you know, found, there's always these Twitter arguments about who was more famous, right? Blah, blah, blah. And there was an argument that happened a couple of years ago. It's like, who was more famous at their peak, Tupac or Snoop? And of course, I jumped in, right, as one does. And I was like, Snoop Dogg was orders of magnitude more famous than Tupac, right? Tupac, obviously, because of his tragic early death, has become this kind of sainted figure. And we sort of reverse project a level of fame onto Tupac that he did not have at the time. Tupac had a couple pop hits. Snoop Doggy Dogg was an absolute sensation. And it was in part because he was pitching himself with this combination that is really hard to balance of sort of menace, sort of this like lurking, you know, this a double consciousness at W.E.B. Du Bois, right? He's very aware of how white America looks at him and he leans into it, right? So he's just like, oh, you want a black criminal? I'm going to give you black criminal, but I'm also going to give you homeboy alone. I'm going to give you the guy who just wants to smoke weed with his friends and ride on the handlebars of his friend's bicycle. Because, you know, there were kids like me who were 13, 14 years old, 15 years old at the time, who had never come near, you know, an AK-47, who had never, you know, seen an actual gang member, but they had done that stuff. And that was super appealing. And so this was the moment. Well, you know, it was after The Chronic. The Chronic came out in late 1992, changed the entire landscape, not just of rap, but of popular music. And then Snoop followed it up. This was the G-Funk kind of moment in 92, 93, 94. And this was the moment when all of a sudden, you know, to top the charts, hip hop didn't have to be MC Hammer, didn't have to be Vanilla Ice. It could be some of the most menacing, scary, vulgar, misogynist, homophobic stuff in existence. And one last note on this, I think that's important to note is, and I was talking to some of the students about this earlier, is that Billboard changed its methodology in 1991. They changed the way that they measured the most popular albums in the country. This didn't mean that albums started selling more. It meant that we were aware in a different way of the albums. Like there was a different metric and you changed the metrics and then you changed the reality. And so what they did was instead of having record store owners voluntarily report album sales to Billboard, which is bizarre, right? You have an indie rock store owner who's like, well, we sell rap, but we're just not going to write those down. We're just going to put all these, you know, Green Day albums or something, you know, at the top of the list. They started scanning barcodes, right? And when you start scanning barcodes, it's not a perfect methodology. A lot of stores weren't part of it. Tower Records wasn't part of it, for instance, initially. It's called SoundScan, by the way. It still exists. Then all of a sudden, everything changes. And what we understand as popular music underwent, you know, because Billboard is sort of like the AccuWeather of popular music, right? It's how we understand the zone of popularity, what we can call popular music. And the first album to hit number one, literally displaced Paula Abdul's Spellbound, was N.W.A. Okay. And it was N.W.A.'s second album with a name I'm not going to say out loud, but which they had to print in reverse on the album cover because stores wouldn't carry it because it had the N-word on it, even though it's spelled with a Z. And the other one I mentioned earlier, this has nothing to do, the other genre of music that all of a sudden Billboard revealed people were buying in bulk was Garth Brooks, Oklahoma Zone, right? And all of a sudden it was like, this was when you started seeing country music just blow up. It was like, holy cow, people are buying country music in spades, right? And people are buying hip hop like crazy. And then, right, the snake eats its own tail, right? Then A&R executives, then record labels are like, nope, now we got to find all these folks. We got to stock our repertoire, our portfolio with more country artists who were doing a Garth Brooks-y kind of country, like a arena rock country, and then more rappers who were doing an NWA style of rap. And so this really was the moment. I think it was the early 90s. This is, I say in the book that hip hop in 90, 91, 92 had its punk rock moment at the same time that it had its pop moment. So this was the moment of MC Hammer and Vanilla Ice and Kid and Play. And this was also the moment of NWA and Ice Cube and Public Enemy at the same time. I mean, this is like a supernova for popular music that really is unequaled. Like you haven't really seen anything like this since. And then, you know, and I was telling some of the students earlier, I said, you know, if you're 20 years old right now, you live in hip hop's world as a participant in popular culture. Pop music is hip hop. Like, whether you want, you know, pop music is black music, period. It has been since the 1940s. It's music that comes out of the black church, right? It's music that comes from jazz, that comes from blues, whether it's, you know, Snoop Dogg, whether it's Taylor Swift, you can trace the lineage back to African-American music, syncopation, things like that. And, but now the actual genres of music are, you know, it's undeniable that the, you know, in the stream, especially in the streaming era, and I talk a little bit about the streaming era in the book, but streaming platforms are essentially rap platforms. Like, that's the music that does the best on streaming platforms.
Man. We have time for one more question.
So this is a great question. There are some artists now who are in the lineage of reality rap, gangster rap. So the only rapper to ever have won a Pulitzer Prize, Kendrick Lamar, is from Compton. He was born the year that Ice-T's first album came out. Okay. And, you know, his family kind of lived, like, he grew up in the mythologized Compton. He grew up in the Compton that was almost like a studio backlot, for popular music. And, you know, he's become one of the greatest rappers, of all time. He's also, I think, understandably, not entirely comfortable with being like the great hope for hip hop. You know, he released his second kind of big non-mixtape album called To Pimp a Butterfly. And the entire album was about how kind of miserable it was to be the savior. And how, you know, and this was a complicated album. There was a lot of jazz on there. There was free jazz on there. There was, you know, him kind of wrestling. There was kind of abstract poetry kind of weaving throughout the album. And he was also, speaking quasi-literally to Tupac Shakur, who was the artist who he looked at as sort of this icon of trying to carry the weight not only of hip hop, but of Black America on his shoulders. But hip hop doesn't have to do what it did in the 90s anymore at the same time. The media landscape is dramatically different than it was in the 90s. And there are not only countless more outlets for folks to kind of be political through social media, I think foremost among them. But popular culture has, to small degrees, I think, improved its representational capacity for stories about everyday Black folks and, you know, telling stories about, you know, police violence against African Americans in a more kind of nuanced way. And so I don't think rappers have to bear that burden as much as they did in the 1990s anymore. And so, and rap is also like so much more heterogeneous than it was. I mean, it's like, goodness, you know, I mean, we were talking about mumble rap from Atlanta at dinner tonight. And, you know, I can't think of anything like if Ice Cube and Chuck D or anything, they do not mumble, right? Not saying that mumble is like the appropriate term, right? But they are bullhorns, right? And you had to shout, you had to yell, you had to be forceful, you had to speak like a church deacon, you had to speak like an air raid siren to be heard in the 1990s. You don't necessarily have to do that anymore. And I think you can see that reflected in, you know, in the fact that, you know, Black Lives Matter movement, Kendrick Lamar's All Right was one of the kind of key songs of that moment. A lot of people said it was sort of the Mississippi Goddamn of the Black Lives Matter movement. There was another song by a rapper named Lil Boozy called Fuck the Police that sounded nothing like NWA's that people saw was sort of an anthem. But there was nothing even remotely close to hip hop's connection to this movement, because this was more a Twitter political movement. It didn't have to use rap as a platform in the same way.
Right, great. And I should add, just by way of closing, that you should all be impressed by just how influential Eric Harvey's thinking is, because Ice Cube and Snoop Dogg are performing at the BOK Center tonight and tomorrow night.
My friends, yes.
So, you know, you're all invited to the after party.
I called them up. We synced it up. It's very, you know, I was very happy that my friends were able to.
This took a lot of planning on the Humanities Center part, but we have that kind of pull here.
We do.
But I do want to, in all sincerity, thank Eric Harvey for a terrific talk this evening.
Thank
all of you for coming out. Thank you who joined us on the stream. We hope to see you at Humanities Center's events in the future, but thank you all. Have a good night. Take care of each other.